Morning. My name is Peter Onuf, and with me on the first panel today, Annette Gordon-Reed, Deborah McDowell, Ed Ayers, and Marian Wright Edelman. I love this audience. Even our names are enough to elicit applause. Today we're going to talk a little bit about the history that is in this place. We're going to explore why it is a good place to be talking about slavery and freedom, about where we've been and where we're going. Monticello is a storied mountain. Many stories have been lived here, and thanks to Cinder and her colleagues, many stories are going to be told here in the future. Our challenge today is to understand how these stories relate to each other. How can we make Monticello a place to come together, to understand what the American experiment was all about, and to assess its continuing successes and failures with an eye toward a deeper understanding of who we are. What we're going to do is begin with a brief discussion that Annette will initiate of the messiness of history that is all a part of Monticello and that Monticello exemplifies so well. It's hard to understand that this is a messy place when you come to the beautiful location of Monticello today. But in many ways, the Monticello of yesterday was both a building site, a constant site of turmoil and work. It was also a place where many generations of enslaved people lived out their lives. To give you a sense of some of that messiness, we begin with Annette.
Well, as a number of people said, this is a perfect place to start talking about that because on one hand, you have Jefferson who, for many people who come here, the destination is to come and see the life of the great man and his great house and remember the great things that he did as an American revolutionary, setting the Declaration of Independence, what has been called America's Creed. We hold these truths to be self-evident. You know these in the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These are all wonderful things. He considered himself to be a man of the Enlightenment and part of the Republic of Letters. So a lot of his time was spent in the house writing the words that we know, discussing these issues. But outside of the house was Mulberry Row, was the people down the mountain, people working on his various crops during the year. As someone mentioned, over 600 people over the course of his life that he owned. Sort of in contravention of these principles that are enunciated in the Declaration of Independence. So we have the messiness is the beauty of the ideal, the beauty of the place, although as you mentioned, it never looked like this. He never saw it looking so good.
Never a crowd like this.
Never a crowd like this. Never a crowd like this, never so beautiful as they maintain it. But the beauty of the natural setting with this ugliness of slavery, and it should be said the ugliness of race. I think we have to, of a conception of race, we have to never forget that slavery in the United States was racially based, and so there had to be a justification for it that was based upon that. And so we get not only the legacy of slavery, of people having been enslaved, we have a legacy of a particular attitude about whites in relationship to blacks, about families. We know the messiness of families. Gail referred to being a descendant of enslaved people here at Monticello, a descendant of members of Jefferson's family as well, a descendant of Jefferson, not direct, but not through him. So that messiness is there. Slavery is not just people working and not getting paid. The auction block, those are symbolic and important parts of it. It was about the creation of families, of biological families, connections. Of all places in Virginia where people are interested in family, obsessed with the notion of family, and obsessed with the notion of race as well. And we have the clash of that here, and how Jefferson dealt with that, and how it was not dealt with. And so this is an important thing to think of as a part of that messiness, the intellectual side of Jefferson's life, the actual day-to-day existence, people working to support him to make sure that his life was comfortable, and that he, well, was not really remunerative, not as much as it could have been, as he wanted it to be, but people made this life possible for him. And then the messiness of family, as was referred to when Jefferson died in 1826, people were auctioned off to pay his debts or to attempt to pay his debts. And they left this place and were dispersed. And that's a story that happened to many people during slavery, something that is not, that people just begin, we, people have talked about it, but understanding the real scope of that now, of the dispersal of African-American people, and what that did to the community and what that meant for America just in general.
Yeah, I'll talk about that a little bit, Annette, thanks. You know, Jefferson chose this place so he could look out across Virginia and the world, the nation from here. One of the things he would have seen was the creation of the largest slave empire in the modern world, that he was both an architect of, a beneficiary of, a worrier about. Up here looking at the Missouri crisis in 1820, a fire bell in the night foreseeing the dissolution of the Union. And the sales that took place on this lawn, the sales of his family once he was gone, would have been repeated a million times. Mm-hmm. A million of the domestic slave trade, of people coming from old places like Albemarle County in Virginia to the new places, Louisiana and Texas and Arkansas and Mississippi. A million. And what that meant was that if you lived in one of these older places, it didn't mean that you were sheltered from the worst of slavery because you weren't working in a cotton field or a sugarcane field. What it meant was that the odds of you being sold away from your mother and your father and your brothers and your sisters was greater. What it meant was that families who had lived here for generations on any day could awaken and find themselves torn apart by the slave trade. And from this mountain and from Virginia, radiating out across an area the size of continental Europe, the great empire of slavery that dominated the United States and its history for generations. We know that one of Jefferson's greatest accomplishments in his old age was creation of the University of Virginia. He could not have imagined 34 years after his death that he could have looked down, maybe with his telescope on at the rotunda, and seen the flag of secession flying from the top of the rotunda that students had crawled up there to unleash. And he certainly could not have imagined that the university and this whole town would have become one giant hospital as young men with shattered lives were shipped here by railroads to suffer and die for the cause of perpetuating a new nation based on slavery. He could not have imagined that as soon as African American people had the opportunity to leave this place, they would. That they would begin going to the north, seeking out cities, going to the cities of Virginia, trying to find a place to make a life for themselves. He could not have foreseen that in 1902, in the very capital that he helped design in Richmond, lawmakers would write a new constitution for the Commonwealth of Virginia that would systematically and unashamedly deprive African American men of the vote and proclaim that was their purpose and enshrine it in the law of the land. Cannot have imagined looking down from here that Charlottesville and Albemarle County and all the rest of the Commonwealth and all the rest of the vast empire of the South would systematically discriminate and segregate people by race that Annette's talking about. So the story here radiates out from Monticello, just as the words of the Declaration of Independence have radiated out from here. So have the systems, the structures, the rationales, the rationalizations, the habits of thought, the dependency of white people on African American people. All those things also radiated out from this place. And so being able to come here and think about looking from here all across the United States, this is a fitting place to recall all the things that had many of their origins here. So that's where we get to the beginning of the 20th century, Marian. Maybe you'd like to.
Well, I'd like to get to the 20th century.
Took us long enough.
Well, again,
how we're going to close the deed between the gap between creed and deed, and that is a challenge that's before us. But I'm going to rely on James Baldwin and Mr. Jefferson's words themselves. So I just want to read two things that I could not think about or speak more eloquently. And Baldwin says, and you know, that history, as nearly no one seems to know, is not merely something to be read, and it does not refer mainly or merely or even principally to the past. On the contrary, the great force of history comes from the fact that we carry it within us, are unconsciously controlled by it in many ways, and history is literally present in all that we do. It could scarcely be otherwise, since it is to history that we owe our frames of reference, our identities, and our aspirations. And so I really want to applaud our being here today and beginning to grapple with this, because only the truth is going to make us free. But I also want to just say that Mr. Jefferson, who wrote the overture of our American's Dream, but I think we should also quote him here, because I think he left us, I think, the marching orders in many ways, even if he could not live it out. In his reality and time. When he asked, can the liberties of a nation be secure when we have removed a conviction that these liberties are the gift of God? Indeed, I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just, that his justice cannot sleep forever. Commerce between master and slave is despotism. Nothing is more certainly written in the book of fate than that these people are to be free, that these people are to be free. The gap between the words and the reality of his deeds is what we're left to close. He gave us the overture of our still unfinished symphony as a nation, and our aspiration as a nation. Now we have got to close that and write the next movement, and we've made enormous progress through the civil rights movement, through all the rebellions over time, to people to justify or close the gap between creed and deed. But I think that what we now have to address ourselves to is how do we close this gap, and how do we write the next movement in this unfinished symphony of American struggle to be free and just and fair? And so I'm delighted to be on this panel. And the real question I hope you're gonna leave here today is, what are we gonna do to build the movement that allows every one of God's children to be able to achieve their potential?
To read something. Thank you for your presence. My goodness, I moved my bookmark.
Something I would do.
I mean, this is unbelievable. Just give me a second. I'm
History
losing.
Is a continually unfolding story.
Yeah. I mean, I had the bookmark, so I could go right to it. I moved the bookmark and then closed the page. Unbelievable.
Well, we've all been there.
Yeah. Oh, good. Thank you for your understanding. Just give me a second. And I don't dare try to.
Is.
No, it's not the yellow bookmark. Oh, here it is. Human, all too human. This is from Toni Morrison's novel, Beloved. I was talking about time. It's so hard for me to believe in it. Some things go, pass on. Some things just stay. I used to think it was my rememory. You know, some things you forget. Other things you never do. Places are still there. If a house burns down, it's gone. But the place, the picture of it, stays. And not just in my rememory, but out there in the world. What I remember is a picture floating around out there outside my head. I mean, even if I don't think it, even if I die, the picture of what I did or knew, or saw, is still out there, right in the place where it happened. Someday you'll be walking down the road and you hear something or see something going on, so clear, and you think it's you thinking it up, a thought picture. But no, it's when you bump into a rememory that belongs to somebody else. Where I was before I came here, that place is real. It's never going away. Even if the whole farm, every tree and grass blade of it dies, the picture is still there. And what's more, if you go there, you who were never there, if you go there and stand in the place where it was, it will happen again. It will be there for you, waiting for you. I read this section from Beloved because of its investments in memory and memories processes that are part of the focus of this summit. But I read it also because of the subtitle of this panel, From Slavery to Civil Rights. I'm quite curious about from two narratives and the ways in which they are invested in our progressivist fantasies as a nation. When we talk about slavery, we inevitably want to talk about how far we've come. We are not there anymore, right? We want to impose on ourselves very artificial notions of time, artificial notions of progress, artificial notions of how long. I'm reminded here of Martin Luther King's famous speech there at the end of the march from Selma to Montgomery, that famous speech that you have to hear and not just read, how long, not long, how long, that you remember that. We are constantly asking as a nation, especially those who hold the power reins, well, how long are these people going to have to dwell on slavery? How many more films do they need about slavery? How many miniseries do they need about slavery?
One more.
When are we going to quit talking about slavery, for heaven's sakes? Let's get over it. And what I want to suggest is, as we think about the stories we need to tell and following Marian, the ways in which we can and need to close the gap between creed and deed, that we need to think about aspects of this history that from two narratives don't much permit us to address. And here I would go back to Gail's, if I may, Gail's opening comments about dispersal, about loss, that in investments in progressivist narratives, we want to move so quickly to the end point. And the end point is, for many of us, the point of triumph, the point of overcoming. We want to get there so fast that we tend to overlook that part of the story where there has not been movement. And here I would focus on what happens to the history of a people who can be so easily separated to liquidate someone else's debts. What do we do and how can we talk about not just labor that is uncompensated, but all of the brokenness that slavery engendered on generations of people? And here I would, in closing, ask us to think about that middle term in the title of the organizers, and that term is mourning. Mourning. Beloved is a book invested in mourning. It is a book invested in giving us, in calling us, in joining us to pause, to stop. That moment in the clearing when Baby Suggs is saying to those congregated, weep. Weep. We're not talking about weeping and stopping at weeping, but I think when we talk about this history, we really need to perhaps subordinate these triumphalist narratives of overcoming, of resistance, of agency, to those parts of the narrative that speak to considerable loss, losses that can never be completely mourned. One last point. I often wonder if Freud could have written Mourning and Melancholia after World War II. He wrote it before. Because there are certain forms of loss, there are certain tragedies that do not admit of closure, our other favorite cultural word. So I would just have us think about how we can insert into our narratives, even as we think about mobilization, how we can insert into our narratives these moments of pause, these moments of retreat, these moments of mourning for losses that can never be repaid. Thank you very much.
Well, I'd like to ask you all what we are to make of this moment. This moment isn't a moment of celebration, though I have to say I feel good with you all here today. It is a wonderful moment, but we haven't come to the end of anything. Closure should be banished from the language.
Agreed.
We're not celebrating, yet we are engaging. And I'd like to know how you all feel about how we can bring the pictures together that you talked about, Deborah, the perspectives that Ed talked about, looking out, we look back from those places, and the history that he imagined Jefferson seeing with astonishment. How do we put that all together? That's another way of saying, what are the legacies of our own history, the legacies that define us, a history that's not a succession of triumphs, but is, as the founders suggested, an experiment.
Well, I the first thing you have to do is you have to know things. Mm-hmm. And
no, really?
Well, you do. No, seriously. I mean, seriously, you have to know things. We refer to the fact that the work that Cinder has done, the work that has been done here, all of this stuff was here. All of this information was always present. All of the things that I've written about, all of it was always there. And the first step, you guys continue with the part afterwards, but the first thing you do is have to know things. You have mm-hmm. to gather the material. You have to understand what actually happened. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we can't get 100% to that, but you can do better mm-hmm. than we had been doing up until, you know, there was sort of the turn in historiography, looking at slavery and looking at history from the bottom up, or however you want to call it. We have to know stuff. So that would be my plea, is to have other places, not just, you know, plantations, enslaved, you know, plantations where people lived, but everywhere, to try to get some handle on American history, to tell the truth about what has happened. And that requires gathering information.
And that's a solid foundation, yeah, because that's something we share.
Absolutely.
And if we establish mm-hmm. what has happened, to whom, and how they might have experienced it, and the stories they've left us, then that's something we have in common.
The first thing we must do is to teach history to our children that is accurate.
And I want to...
And I think that, you know, John Hope Franklin and Carter Woodson, and I just applaud our digging into it, but we cannot have new generations of children growing up with the myths of the past and acting on the myths of the past. And so we should really help all of us understand, you know, I call it the fundamental birth defect. And it wasn't just about, it was for privileged white men after 100 years of this terrible thing, transformation that went on. The culture and the nation was built on slavery, and they did not want to give up white male privilege and the wealth that came with that, South as well as nationally. And so we really kind of have to confront that, because it not only this birth defects, they affected me as a woman, they affected, you know, people who didn't have property rights, and they sold them their whiteness, but deprived them of equal participation in the Constitution. In the life of this country. So I think coming to grips with that, and so there is an urgency that I feel. about sort of doing away with the myths of history, and really teaching our children the truth about who we are and where we came from, but how we are changing that gap between creed and deed and what they can do to change that gap between creed and deed. So textbooks, and I know you've got an education program here to talk about how we write the truth in our textbooks, but I cannot say how important I think that is. And secondly, because of the timing of all this, this country is always, some people in this country are always eager to go back to the past. And we're at the most dangerous point in our history that we've had in a very long time. And we need to talk about it. We need to mobilize against it, because this snake never goes away. It just keeps flaring up. So I just hope that we can focus on how do we educate ourselves, and this is a wonderful forum today. But how do we get that out to all of our children, into our curriculums, into whatever, because we are still a rather historically ignorant people.
And we don't want to go back to that mythical past, because the message is there is a past that we need to recover.
You know, if you think about where we stand in the story, of the telling of the story, we're a lot closer to the beginning than we are to the end of this. And if you can think about here, we've had testimony from Senator Stanton remembering what it was like to be here. And I remember when we came here and you could come here and just hear about the servants and so forth, you know, and we've seen the beginning of change. But we live in a time not only that presents these incredible challenges that are so deep and so pervasive, but we have new opportunities, and Monticello's pioneering this, new ways to tell stories. New ways with all through electronic means to do this, but also new ways with the expectation of beginning with honesty and working from there. And I think that what's beautiful about the possibilities before us, we cannot rectify the past. We can acknowledge it and acknowledge our own part of being complicit in the heritage that we've inherited. People like to talk about our heritage. The thing is, you inherit everything. You don't just get the nice silver and the china. You get everything with all this, right?
Sometimes you don't get the china and the...
Oh, there's that. Exactly. And so the point is that with the sense of urgency that you spoke, it's never been more important that we figure this out. But it seems that if we would begin pledging at places like this, building on the recent record of here, begin with the truth, you could build a lot more solid foundation than we've ever had before. Centuries to make up for, so we better get to work.
It's important to remember, though, all stories are not created equal.
No.
And every story impinges on and only makes sense in the context of all the other stories. And that's why the reconstruction of a place like this and all the experiences here is so crucial. The great enemy in modern times and modernity is the notion of relativism. I have my story. It works for me. That's the word heritage signifies that. No, you don't get to do that. Your story has to be part of our story.
Yes, I often quote her, Virginia Scharf, who's written about Jefferson. The first time I met her, she said something that I think, you know, I had been trying to do just myself, but I thought I valued in other people. She said, she asked the question, what if everybody in Jefferson's life mattered?
What an astonishing question.
How would you write? And because really, if you think about it, instead of having people, the people around him, enslaved people, even his white family, having them as props that are just there to try to highlight them, what if you took every one of those people seriously and told their stories? Then even if you were just interested in Jefferson, you would see him in a different light if the people around them had the power that they actually did have in their life. Burl Colbert, all kinds of people who are, in terms of status, if we look back at it, status are enslaved people, but the connection that's there, the way they interacted, what he meant in his life, in each other's lives, you know, it's not a sentimental thing, it's the reality of trying to get at how these people lived. So you're right, it's this notion that if you can get everybody's story together, the story becomes real, and those are the stories that we have to try to tell, and what they've been trying to do here. And it brings that sadness that you're talking about as well, because the tragic side of it the people who are not getting the silverware or whatever, the, or not being deprived of it, you see them too. Yeah. They're alive.
You absolutely do. The historian Nell Painter has written a wonderful short essay, very suggestive essay, called Soul Murder. And calling for a fully loaded, her terms, a fully loaded cost accounting of slavery. And there she is talking about the brokenness, people who emerge from that institution completely broken, who did not triumph, who did not weather, there was no happy ending or even a livable ending for many following this experience. That can all sound so kind of morbid on a beautiful day here on this mountain, but again, it's not that that is the whole story. That is the piece of the story. But I would also suggest, I remember too, and this is another book I'd highly recommend to people who may not have read it, by Craig Wilder, Ebony and Ivy, and he's looking at the slavery as the foundation of so many of our major educational institutions, including the one at which I worked, the University of Virginia. But he came to Virginia some couple of years ago, and he asked a question, or titled his remarks, "Who's Afraid of the Archive?" and so I kind of got my fancy pants on and said, we are not afraid of the archive, I fear. We are actually, we better be careful that however much we need to know, and we do, we need to know stuff, as Annette says, but we need to know that stuff at the same time that we don't retreat to that stuff as a way of avoiding talking about the reverberations of that stuff in the present moment. And so it can be really wonderful for universities to establish slavery commissions, for Georgetown to say it will offer admission, open admission to all descendants of slaves on which the university was built, et cetera. All of these are salutary efforts, I would concede. But we have to think about when we talk about from to, we must talk about the then in the now, all right? And the then in the now, the examples are legion, and we have to then balance these accounts. We have to know what happened in slavery, but we also have to give close and careful attention to the reverberations of slavery, the conditions that were started there that continue to reverberate in the lives of people who are the descendants of the enslaved.
And can we then move on to the actions that are needed now?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, this thing keeps reoccurring in lots of ways, and I'm pleased about the debate. Mm-hmm. But you know, we know the history of Jim Crow and lynchings, and we know the marvelous hopefulness that was brought by the civil rights movement. We now see, though, you know, new iterations. There's an endless creativity in how do you re-enslave black folk and other folks of color and people who are poor. You know, we've got something which I now call the cradle to prison pipeline. And it is, and we've got addressed, as we address the individual actions that we all need to take, we need to address the policies and the systems that reinstitute. We still have separate but unequal education in this country for the majority of our children, and we need to address that. And illiteracy was a major problem. We know about poverty. We have children are the poorest group of Americans. It's a disgrace that we let our youngest be our poorest age group, and they are disproportionately poor, and that 80% almost of our black children cannot read at grade level in fourth and eighth grade and drop out of school in extraordinary numbers. What is a child going to do in this globalizing competitive world? Mm-hmm. They can't read or compute at the most basic levels. It's slavery. It's prison. We need to speak up, and we need to understand what is happening here. The assault on voting rights, the assault on voting rights and the corruption of the political process by money. I mean, wake up. Wake up. I mean, these are things that are fundamentally saying we want our country back. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love, there's a billboard in Tennessee, which I have, it's a Saturday and I'm off duty, right? My lawyers are so restrictive. But there's an honest billboard from somebody running for Congress in Tennessee that's on the highway, where somebody sent me saying, I am the candidate for white people. Mm-hmm. I love his honesty, because mm-hmm. we need to understand that that's where we are now mm-hmm. in our political debates, through lots of euphemisms and all the other.
That's where we are, that's where we've been.
That's where we've been, that's where we are, but that's where we've got to stop mm-hmm. being. And we've got to build that next effort. You know, I mean, I love having Harriet Tubman now recognized on the bill. We have such a history, a rich history as black folk, that we need to make sure that our children know and walk and term, and that gets back to the books that they read, what they know and how we teach our history, because we can do this. What have we done? We've done miracles. We've done miracles. And the resilience and what we've overcome over our years is what we need to pass on to our children, and we can do that. And that's why things like freedom schools and the teaching of things in our schools, it all ought to be about empowering children and affirming the progress, but affirming the importance of each of us taking responsibility for changing the narrative that comes from our history. So I think this is another watershed moment in our history when we can get ourselves together and to finish the next movement of this unfinished symphony that Mr. Jefferson envisaged but did not live.
Well, Jefferson did talk about what you're talking about, yep. Marian. He told us in a famous letter he wrote to James Madison in 1789 that the earth belongs to the living.
That's right.
And we must look to future generations, because our stewardship now over the earth that we control, over the land that we rule, is going to leave the conditions for the rising generation. So they need to know where they came from. They need to know where they're going. And he believed, in a way that we don't believe, that there was going to be a progressive enlightenment of the world, and that one day the light would come to all of us. Well, it may be flickering in our own time, but we got to do our best to keep it lit. And I think one of the things you're telling us, we professional historians love to keep our history at a distance so we can be objective. We have to see from all points of view. But we have to recognize at the same time that we are generating stories. We are the story for future generations. How will they read our history?
Well, there's also the fear that historians have of talking about the present. The notion that, what do we call presentism, the idea that the past really speaks to today, or doing things in, but you think that that's one of the ways we view it. And it's difficult with this history because it's so close to us. You know, a Jefferson descendant, Lucian Truscott, talks about having met his great-grandmother who, as a little girl, had met Jeff Randolph's daughter. So in other words, he was basically like one or two people between, you know, Jefferson and his life, degrees of separation. This is all so new. And so as history, it's not really the past in a way. It's so close to us, and I think that's one of the things that makes it difficult for people. The guilt on the part of many whites, the sort of talking about heritage and defensiveness about all of this makes it difficult to have the conversation. But we've been doing it much more now, I think, than we have, obviously, than we were in the past when you were showing up here and people were talking about servants. It's moved on, but it's still that the insecurity, the defensiveness is there.
Well, I love the new African American Museum, which is going to open up, which is going to help us move on. My maternal ancestry home is Charleston, and there's a new slavery museum underway, and that's another step forward in a wonderful way. I mean, we're all doing ancestor.com, and we're all trying to kind of reclaim our legacy. Brian Stevenson, who's a remarkable young man, And read his book, Just Mercy, if you haven't.
Right.
But what he's now doing, he's creating a new lynching museum, and all of our young people who come to Hilly Farm for training are now beginning to go out and get the dirt at lynching sites, which he's identified. And so we're having a real movement forward and coming to grips with our history, and he's gotten the slavery markers up in Montgomery. So we're at a good time in many ways and opening our eyes. The issue is, how do we translate that into systemic and policy change, and how do we create those next movements? And we know what to do. Our children have got to learn how to read and write and be able to compete in an economy on a fair basis. And we need to be out there building the biggest noise that you've ever had to insist that we move forward, because if you can't read or compute, if you don't have health care, if you don't have a strong early childhood foundation, we know what to do. So the burden is really with us. We have an enormous moment of opportunity and an obligation to try to lighten the path, lighten us about the past, but more importantly now, to do what we have to do to write that next movement in our symphony of American struggle. So I just think that it's a wonderful time to be alive. It's a hard time to be alive, but let's get on with it so that our children don't have to fight the same old battles that we fought.
Well, we should continue this conversation indefinitely, and I'd enjoy that. That's what we do when we historians get together. And I agree with Marian. This is a moment of enormous hope from within the history business, though we worry about the future of the history business, given support for education diminishing and the emphasis on STEM. And the work of the National Endowment is so important for that. And our challenge then is to take the energy that we can generate within a revision of history, in a demolition of mythic misunderstandings, in a recovery of our shared history. This is our great opportunity, but it's not that the world out there is ready to receive us and what we're saying. That's something that we need to sustain. That's our challenge within the business, because there's nothing that's going to last forever. And this is Deborah's point about mourning, I think, and pausing. Well, the pause could be the end. It doesn't necessarily resume, and that very much is up to us. And it's up to you, and we're very grateful for you for having come here today, because it's rare that we get the opportunity to speak to a group like this and to feel that maybe you could join our conversation. Thank you very much.